morning.
Good morning.
All of you out there in viral land, or virtual, not viral, virtual land. Let's hear that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. Good to see each and every one of you here this morning as we gather together to worship and to praise our Lord and our Savior. Now get this, this is the last day of January. Wow. 1 month as of midnight tonight will be in the past. As we look forward to Tuesday, which is Grunsavtog, which is Groundhog Day. That'll give us either a month and a half or 6 weeks of winter weather or inclement weather. As we start that downhill slide towards spring and all the summer activities that go with that. Looking forward to that. I hope you are too. I'm looking forward to a time of worship here this morning and all the times that we've planned together to come together to praise God. And by way of announcements, I guess the year-end reports need to be at Susan Hess so that she can tabulate them so that we have them for the congregation meeting, which is on February the 15th at 7 p.m. Those two go together. Also, if you would like tithing envelopes, see Mary Funk, who will more than likely be sporting a new tan as of right now. Her and her husband are celebrating an anniversary in some south tropical Jamaica is where they're at. And we also would ask that you remember them as they return back to the United States. Okay, so wise cards are available from the individuals who we have mentioned before. And also, Operation Christmas Child continues. This month's collections would be hats, gloves, scarves, bar soap, washcloths, and toothbrushes. So if any of those items that you wish to contribute for Operation Christmas Child, which will be going out in November of this year, we would ask that you would bring them to the church or see one of the church members, and we'll make sure that it gets to the appropriate distribution site. Any other announcements? And seeing none, then let's turn our attention to the reason that we've assembled here this morning, and that is to worship and to praise God. We'll open with our responsive reading, which is found on page 180 of our hymnals. If you have one, you can follow along. It's, He is our strength. Walk with the Lord. Walk before God. Walk in His fellowship with God. It is an ordinary, everyday walk which will be attacked. And yet, we need never crash. We have two glorious words with which to confront the adversary, but God.
We are all weakness, but God is the strength of my heart.
Before the command was given to Abram, he was told that wonderful name of the Lord, I am El Shaddai, the Almighty God, the God who is enough.
He is our eternal strength, and with Him we can walk this day and every day of our lives.
We did this recently, not too long ago, but it bears repeating that He is our strength. And our everyday walk is being attacked each and every day as we're out in the world, out in that area that has rejected the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ and in its place have adopted the darkness of evil. And Lord, there's just so much of that out there, and we need all the strength that you can muster within us to be able to confront all of those adversaries. But with two powerful words, but God. You and God are a majority. So praise God for that. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Now we have a children's song coming up. And I get to be a helper this morning.
Yep, Ron's going to be a helper. He's going to point to the body. Where are we going to sing about? It's oh, be careful. So the first one is the little eyes, and then your little ears, and then your little tongue, and then your little hands, and your feet. Okay, be careful where you go.
Can you hold your tongue and sing at the same time?
No, I can't. All right. Oh, be careful.
Which a lot of biblical truth to it, and I think our helper in the audience pointed me in the right direction because I couldn't hear what she was singing.
She made me laugh.
Oh, who has more fun than a bunch of Christians?
That's right. Amen.
All right. Our opening hymn this morning is number 679, and we'll follow that up with just 680. Two songs just dovetail together. The first one is Freely, Freely, and the second one is People Need the Lord. And oh, how that is so true this morning.
God forgave.
That he lives is because people need to live. brings to light and throws away all the darkness. Lord, it is the name of Jesus. And you have given of yourself freely. Freely you have given. And freely we receive. It can't be bought. It can't be worked for. It can't be earned. It's received freely. And Lord, as we sang this song, we know that there's people out there that need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of all the broken dreams, promises of mankind, like one individual says, what all else matters on earth, it just boils down to what we've done with Jesus. That's the end of it. That's the whole nutshell, what we have done in our lives with Jesus. You have given yourself for all of mankind, for all of eternity, freely to accept or reject. Oh, people need the Lord. People need you, Lord. And Lord, may we be the instruments that you have called us to be the hands and the feet, to show the love and the compassion and the truth that is found only in our Savior. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Scripture today is from Philippians 3 and 17 to 20. Brethren, join in following my example and note those who so walk as you have us for a pattern. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their mind on earthly things, for our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. May God add his blessing to this reading.
Our next hymn will be Open the Eyes of My Heart. We're going to try and put the words up on the overhead, and hopefully you're able to see that and then be able to sing along with us.
Power and love as we sing, holy, holy.
heart. Boy, what a prayer that would be. An answer to prayer if the whole world would open up their eyes and see Jesus.
Amen.
All right. Praise God for that. This morning's message is entitled, Does It Grieve Us? If you've been following along for the last month, we've been looking at somewhat of evangelism and how to determine and how to help the body of Christ grow. We've established that, you know, that everyone has to make a decision as to whether they accept Christ or reject Him. The decision is that individual person. And also we've talked about within the body of Christ, within the house of God, that there are both ministers and there are ambassadors. We are all called to do something that God has given us to proclaim the truth that sets the hearts of men and women, children, free for all eternity. We're all ministers, and God has placed us at different locations throughout our sphere of influence, where we're at on our everyday walk with the Lord. And we've also established that, you know, that there's folks out there that sometimes they feel rejected or they feel not qualified, but yet you are. Jesus has commanded. Now, He didn't make a suggestion. He said, I command you to go out and teach, to preach, and to make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So we are all called to go out into the world, beyond the four walls of this brick and mortar church, to the mission fields that are beyond these walls. And as we end up this month, we're going to be looking at the events that take place within the body of Christ, within the church. There's a situation that Paul addresses and has addressed it numerous times, but he bears down on it here in Philippians. There's things that are happening in the church at Philippi. And this application has parallels to, of course, the Word of God has its original intent and the meaning thereof and what it was addressed to and to whom it was addressed to and how it applies to us. But there's also a parallel to this that's not taking the scripture out of context, but is making us an awareness of some of the things that are taking place. And of course, we read this passage of scripture last week about being the enemies of the cross. Now, when we think of enemies of the cross, we immediately, our mind goes to, you know, those who don't know Jesus, those who are habitually in a sinful life, or a sinful lifestyle. They are rejecting the cross. They are rejecting not the wooden beams, not those two wooden gibbets that stood on the hill outside of Jerusalem called Mount Calvary. That's not what we're talking about when we speak of the cross. What we're speaking of the cross is the benefits thereof. And of course, the supreme benefit is the eternal salvation offered through Jesus Christ freely. Freely He gave. And freely, freely we receive. But along with eternal, the salvation offered by Jesus Christ, there also then comes the victory of a daily walk, our walk through this world, and how we can have victory over sin. We can have victory over all those things that tie us. We can have victory over materialism. We can have victory over greed and things that tie us to material world. Now, I'm not speaking sinless perfection. That comes when we stand before the Lord. But until that time, each of us, we struggle with things. But what we see here, when we think of enemies of the cross, course, we think of those that reject Jesus. But some that will even reject the very existence of God. There seems to be a growing move to eradicate God from every aspect and area of our lives, whether it be in the secular world, and in some cases, it is infiltrated into the church. It has become, the world is influencing the church, the body of Christ, instead of the opposite way around. It should be the body of Christ and the truth and the good news impacting the world. But we don't see that. We see the opposite. There's things that we see that sometimes will tear at our heart. Does anything bring you to tears? Maybe it's when you see pictures of devastation and destruction. Individuals for whom no reason of their own have been involved in a catastrophe. I'll get it out yet. A disaster, that's better. A disaster in their lives that they had no control over. There's individuals who are born with multiples of disabilities. And of course, sometimes you'll see their pictures being flashed across the stage to be able to offer up a donation, to show compassion for those for whom are helpless, for those who are homeless. Does that bring you to tears? Does it grab at your heart? Or have we become so jaded, calloused, and non-caring that we can just watch those images before our very eyes and just say, and just think, well, that's not happening here, so it doesn't affect me. Mm-hmm. One of the most devastating blights on the world affect the helpless, the innocents of life. Individuals who have no control over what's happening in their world because of some despot, dictator, or that decided that he or she wanted to rule and reign. Of course, this month is Sanctity of Human Life Month. Mm-hmm. We see that the numbers of people who are dying, and we hear it on the radio recently as every day, how many coronavirus deaths there are locally, statewide, nationwide, worldwide. You want to know what the biggest cause of death in the world is? It has nothing to do with the virus. It has nothing to do with the disease. But it's a symptom of a sin-sick world. It's called abortion. The stat that was given earlier this week, each year there are 94 million children aborted worldwide.
That's horrible.
Does it cause you to grieve? Does it pull at your heart? It should. But yet, too often, we just stand and watch it go by. How many of you remember when Hurricane Andrew went through the southern tip of Florida? It leveled the town of Homestead, Florida. It's just completely devastated. I remember, and I think that was back in the early 90s, or whenever that was. There was a gentleman who lost his home. And of course, they reopened the streets, to traffic to flow through to get in services and things like that. And of course, any of you who's been around, any type of an incident somewhere, whether it be a fire or an accident, we have these people that just drive by and they just look. They gawk or rubberneck or what's happening. Well, this individual whose home that had been totally destroyed sort of got fed up with that. And he put up a sign in his front yard. It says, Don't look. Just help. Get out and help. You know. And sometimes that's the way we need to see when we look at the things that are happening around us. We just can't look. We've got to get involved. We've got to help. Whether it be a compassion type organization, through a church, through an organization, that's being the hands and the feet of Christ. You know, Jesus himself, here's a challenge for you, church. I want you to go through the Bible, especially go through the New Testament, through the four Gospels, and see how many times the word compassion is used. And how Jesus had compassion on the folks who gathered around. Now guess what? They weren't all members of his church. They weren't all members of his community. They were members, individuals from all over. He healed the sinner and he healed the saint. He had compassion on them. Should we not be likewise? But what the Apostle Paul is writing here, when it said, they are enemies of the cross, this takes place within the body of Christ. There was some activity going on there that he needed to address. And I would encourage you to turn in your Bibles to the passage of scripture that Jamie read there, Philippians chapter 3, and it's verses 17 through 20. Here we see the Apostle Paul sending a letter to the church. Now, we have to realize that Paul is not sending a letter to the Philippian Gazette that everybody's going to read. He's not sending it to the post at Philippi. This message and the messages throughout are directed to the church. How often we see, you know, all the things that are happening in the world. You know, especially back there in 1 Timothy chapter 4 and 2 Timothy chapter 3 and Peter, you know, where in Timothy it talks about in the last days, and it goes through that long list of stuff that's happening. And Peter addresses that in the end times there'll be scoffers and all. Oh, you know what? They weren't addressing the general population. They were addressing the body of Christ. All these things that are spoken of will take place. A great falling away. And the result of that is some of those things that are listed in those particular verses. And that's what Paul's addressing here. He's saying, brethren. He wasn't sending it to the Kiwanis or whatever organization. You know, you name the organization, the Kiwanis just came to mind, or a Rotary Club, or Odd Fellows, or whatever. He was sending it to the church. Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk, so you have us as an example. In other words, these individuals, for many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping. Because of the individuals and the activities that were going on in the church, these folks who proclaimed Christ as their Savior didn't reflect an inward moving of the Holy Spirit. He said they are enemies of the cross. They are preaching another gospel. He says, I write to you even weeping. The same way that Jesus, when he stood outside of Jerusalem, just days before the crucifixion. In Luke chapter 19, it says this, now as he drew near, he saw the city and wept over it, saying, if you had only known, even you, especially in your day, the things that make for your peace. But now they are hidden from your eyes. For the days will come when your enemies will build an embankment around you and surround you and will close you in on every side and level you and your children within you to the ground. And they will not leave one stone upon another because you did not know the time of your visitation. Jesus was crying out as he overlooked the city of Jerusalem, the capital, the center point of the faith, the nation of Israel, and all those folks that were in the temple, all those religious leaders, not all of them, there were some that believed that Jesus is who he said he was. Nicodemus was one of them. Mm-hmm. And he came to Jesus by night.
Nick at night.
But see, they didn't recognize who Jesus was. They refused because of their blindness. They wanted to keep their status quo. They wanted to keep their position. They wanted to have it their way. Totally opposite. And Jesus wept over them. Oh, if you had only known. If you would only see what's right before your very eyes. The fulfillment of the prophecy. The coming of the Messiah, which is Jesus. They wouldn't recognize it. They wanted it their way. Here we see Paul weeping as he writes this letter to the church of Philippi. They are enemies of the cross. I want you to identify them. I want you to mark them. I want you to be able to not so much point them out, but know who they are. Who they are and what they teach and what they preach and how they live and how they walk. I want you to mark them. And that's not the first time the apostle says that. He says it also in Romans. You know, it wouldn't be a good Sunday if I didn't refer to Romans. Romans is the mechanics, the how-to book in the Word of God. Romans chapter 16 says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause division and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you have learned. For they which serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple." You see, there's individuals out there, there is some churches, there is some ministers, there is some folks out there that distort the Word of God. They use it to their own advantage to deceive. Now, the Scripture says the simple. But you know, it's one thing to be simple-minded, but not be simple-minded because you don't know what's in the Word of God. You see, that's the defining point there. That's where we discover when someone walks up to you and says something that you know is totally object and opposite the Word of God, you can say, you're not going to get me. You see, these individuals that were in the church, and before, you know, if you mark someone, if you point them out, you know, there's liable to be someone in your, you can't say that about someone. Because in Scripture it says, don't mark, don't harm God's anointed. That goes back to 1 Chronicles. You can read it there, 1 Chronicles 16 and 22. Don't do them any harm. You can't say those things. If they're preaching false doctrine and false belief systems, yes, you can. They need to know the truth. But what were these individuals doing? What was Paul grieving about to the church at Philippi? Why was he so concerned about what was going on? And he says, "I have told you often." So it's an ongoing activity. It's not a one-time and done deal. If it would have just been, I didn't want to say it often. So it's more than once. And now I tell you, even weeping, he was so grieved by the activity who these believers said they were, but in all actuality, they weren't. You know, this wearing masks in church is not a new thing. There's been folks wearing masks for years in churches. They come to church. Their profession didn't match their confession. You know, their walk didn't match their talk. Oh, but only on Sunday morning. They're Sunday morning saints and Monday morning apes. On Sunday morning, they proclaim God as their Father. But Monday through Saturday, they live like an orphan. These folks wanted Jesus on their terms. You know, it's almost like saying that you're a believer in Jesus Christ was like a check mark in a bucket list. I'll check that box. Well, got that done, now I can move on to something else. You see, being able to identify an individual, we need to mark them. And if we know who they are, does it grieve us when they preach another gospel to someone else in the world whom they will deceive? Scripture says here, they're enemies of the cross, whose end is destruction. You know, they're operating on their own desires, their own appetites, their own personal satisfaction, whose glory is their shame, whose God is their belly. Now, they're operating on their own wishes, desires, you know, and sometimes I'll even think just a little bit outside the box. How many of you know that someone whose God is their belly, they want a perfect, I don't know what size, but a flat belly? You know, they'll do anything. They'll diet, they'll exercise, they'll do whatever that's required to make themselves look good in public. You know, physical fitness, yes, we need to do some physical exercise, and some of us, I'm speaking of myself, need a little more. But to the point where it becomes our God, no. Our God, or an idol. You know what the definition of an idol is? Anything that's more important than God. I know a lot of folks that go around chasing portraits of dead presidents and they fold them up and put them in a drawer. Their God is money. Their God is their, you know, their homes. You might have the most pristine, immaculate, clean, well-trimmed house. But you know what? I've been in some of them places. Their basements aren't any different than anybody else's. They got cobwebs too. They don't go down there. Of course, nobody sees that except for me. Or every once in a while, I gotta go down and get a can of something. It's amazing. All the cobwebs and stuff. Now, this is a freebie. This is what I usually tell folks. You know, I tell them I've been going to dirty websites before there was home computers.
Yep.
Yeah, so I catch a lot of cobwebs off my hat. So yeah, we need to mark these individuals, identify them, but we need not be like the disciples. You know, there in Luke, they just came back from being out there sharing the gospel and doing things for Jesus when he had sent them out. And as they came back, they were all so happy and they enjoyed that which was taking place. And it's Luke chapter 9. It says, when the disciples, James and John, they saw an individual who was casting out demons in the name of Jesus. And this ruffled them a little bit. They said to Jesus, you know, he's not one of us. He's not one of, you know, he's not a member of our gang here, you know. He's casting out demons in your name. Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? You know, that's sort of the attitude that some folks get when they decide that they want to mark someone or they realize someone is operating outside the will of God. They don't grieve for them. They want to destroy them. I'm not sure if I can let our tongue about it. You know, while we pause here very briefly on gossip, when you look in the Bible and you see the word gossip, you look that word up, it says malicious harm. And that takes us back to the book of Exodus. The same word used for thou shalt not murder is the same word used to describe gossip. Ooh. So whenever we gossip about someone, we're wishing that we could murder them. If not so much murder their physical body, but murder their lifestyle and harm them. So we need to be careful, but yet we need to be grieving for those individuals. And that's what Paul was saying to the church there at Philippi. Yeah, these folks are still doing it. We need to reach out to them. We need to be not like Noah, or excuse me, like Jonah. Like, you know, Jonah said, you know, God told him, I want you to go to Nineveh, which is that way. Which way did Jonah go? He went that way. He said, Why should I go to Nineveh? Those folks don't deserve to hear, I'm paraphrasing, they don't deserve to hear the salvation message that God can bring. That's a tough decision to make. That's a tough stance. Of course, Jonah figured out that God was serious about sending him there. But these individuals here that Paul is writing about, you know, Paul is, when he's writing this, he says, the enemies of the cross, you know, were they destroying the doctrine of Christ, the salvation message? Well, they thought that they knew what that meant. Or were they rejecting the efficiency and the practical influence that the Holy Spirit has on an individual. You see, once you accept Jesus Christ by faith, we get more than just salvation. We get the Holy Spirit that now resides within us. And then he begins that cleanup process. You know, we can't say where we were. When we accept Jesus Christ as Savior, people, places, and things have to change. To not change would put us in the same position as these individuals here who are enemies of the cross. Who have the opportunity to change, provided someone tells them the truth. And see, we see that in churches. You know, we see individuals who on Sunday are wearing their mask, and yet we just let it slide. We don't pull that individual off to the same and say, hey, brother, hey, sister. Not in a condemning way. What you're involved in is outside the will of God. You see, the Holy Spirit, when he moves and works within us, he begins to change us. We become a new man, a new person. We're ever changed from glory to glory. We're becoming more Christ-like. If we're not, something's wrong. And it's a process. And I'm not talking about becoming perfect. None of us will do that. Even the Apostle Paul did that. You read about that in Romans chapter 7, where he did some things that he was not proud of, sinful activity. And then you see the redemption that comes along in Romans chapter 8. He was already saved, but he got forgiveness. So we're being changed forever from glory to glory. And how do we do this? How do we change? The same way that we came in. By faith. By faith we walk. By faith we continue to grow. By faith we begin to realize that everything that we have is a benefit from the cross of Jesus Christ. Salvation, sanctification, glorification comes by faith. The infilling of the Holy Spirit comes by faith. And as that faith begins to grow, we get stronger in our faith. We don't need to worry about tomorrow because I know who holds my hand.
That's right.
And we take that by faith. We don't need to be consumed with all the stuff that's going on around us, you know, especially here in the United States. I don't know who's listening, maybe someplace worldwide. We need not to worry about what's taking place within the political realm, within the realm of our nation and the destruction thereof. God's got it. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I mentioned a couple of weeks ago about, you know, folks seem to be all upset and concerned, and rightfully so. I don't like the direction that this world is going in, our nation is going in. But I know somebody who has it all under control. And by faith, I know that he's going to take care of it. May not be what my binder wants, but it'll be what he wants. Heavens, as we look at Scripture, heaven knows we should be getting all excited about the rapture of the church. Because we see things falling into place, moving around. The book of Revelation and the prophets are coming true. Draws us ever nearer to that grand and glorious moment when the trumpet of God shall sound and the dead in Christ shall rise, and we who are alive and remain will be called up to meet the Lord in the air and be with the Lord just for that day.
No.
Forever. Praise God. Amen. And we take that by faith. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. Wow. But the question here before the house this morning is, when we see these things that are unfolding before our very eyes in a worldwide perspective and also in the church perspective, does it grieve us? Does it bring us to tears when we see individuals who are walking outside of the will of God? And for some of them, maybe they've never made a profession of Christ for the first time. Knowing how near and dear the rapture of the church is. Wow. Would they miss that calling away? And that's part of being an evangelist. That's part of being a minister, an ambassador, a preacher, teacher, a confidant, a friend. Does it grieve you to know that your friend might spend an eternity lost in a godless, dark, burning hell? We have some work to do. And there doesn't seem to be a shortage of individuals who need to hear the gospel. And it's not just to fill this church. Right now we're running a little low. Join us now as we gather together to sing our closing hymn. Open the eyes that I may see. Open our eyes that we may see someone who is in need, someone who is lost, someone who needs to feel the touch of the Master's hand. Maybe for the first time to receive the gift so freely offered. Open our eyes. May that be the cry of our heart, the desire of our lives. Number 403.
Yeah.
this week I chose that song to be a closing hymn. And I never knew how close it would be to what we were talking about in our lives, to our lives. Open our hearts, Lord, that we may see, illuminate us, that we may see a need in someone's life this week. And when we come back next week, may we be able to share that grand and glorious testimony of how I witnessed to Christ, for Christ. And maybe you'll win a soul. Maybe you'll plant a seed. Maybe you'll water one. But ultimately, God gets the glory. But we're called to do that. Let's be obedient. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for its instructions and how it leads us, guides us, and directs our paths every waking moment of every day. Keep us safe, Lord, as we go from here to beyond to our homes. Lord, there's some snow out front there, so keep us all safe as we travel. Be with us now, Lord, in these times now and the days ahead. Watch over and protect those who are not with us this morning, those who are facing some sort of illness or situation in their life. Reach down and touch them. May they sense and know that your spirit is real. Lord, we pray for those who are missing a loved one this week. And Lord, for whose loved one may be in a constant care facility or a hospital. Lord, give both the patient and also the loved one the confidence to know that you're right there with them. Lord, we just ask these things in the matchless, powerful name of our soon-coming King and Savior, Jesus Christ.